हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज असरा सुल्ताना, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन रिप्ले डिपार्टमेंट, वर्किंग इन आईएसएल इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज. सो टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट यूनिट 5 ऑफ पावर सिस्टम ऑपरेशन एंड कंट्रोल सब्जेक्ट फॉर ट्रिपल फाइनल ईयर स्टूडेंट्स. सो लेट अस सी द कंटेंट्स ऑफ यूनिट 5. सो यूनिट 5 डील्स विद द रिएक्टिव पावर कंट्रोल एंड रिएक्टिव पावर जनरेशन बाय सिंक्रोनस जनरेटर्स, ऑटोमेटिक वोल्टेज रेगुलेटर्स, फैक्स कंट्रोलर्स, FACTS फैक्स कंट्रोलर्स, TCSE. अंडर दैट वी आर हैविंग TCSE, स्टैटकॉम एंड UPFC. सो वी नीड टू नो देयर प्रिंसिपल ऑफ ऑपरेशन, देयर कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स, देयर एडवांटेजेस, डिसएडवांटेजेस एंड एप्लीकेशंस. सो बिफोर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट एक्चुअल यूनिट, वी हैव टू फर्स्ट सी वॉट इज रिएक्टिव पावर, वॉट इज द नीड फॉर रिएक्टिव पावर एंड वॉट इज द नीड फॉर रिएक्टिव पावर कॉम्पनसेशन, शंट कॉम्पनसेशन, सीरीज कॉम्पनसेशन, स्टैटिक वीआर कॉम्पनसेटर्स, स्टैटिक कॉम्पनसेटर्स, स्टैटकॉम स्टैटिक कॉम्पनसेटर्स एंड सिंक्रोनस कंडेंसर. सो लेट अस फर्स्ट सी द इंट्रोडक्शन, दैट इज रिएक्टिव पावर कॉम्पनसेशन, दैट इज VAR और कॉम्पनसेशन और रिएक्टिव पावर कॉम्पनसेशन इज नथिंग बट मैनेजमेंट ऑफ रिएक्टिव पावर टू इम्प्रूव द परफॉर्मेंस ऑफ AC सिस्टम्स. So reactive power compensation is defined as the management of reactive power to improve the performance of AC systems. So in this we are having two aspects. First one is load compensation, second one is voltage support. Okay. So under load compensation, the main objectives are increase the power factor of the system. Okay. We are compensating the load, that is load compensation we are doing to increase the power factor of the system. Second one is to balance the real power drawn from the system. Third one is compensate voltage regulation. Fourth one is to eliminate the current harmonics. Now let us see the second one, voltage support. So main purpose is to decrease the voltage fluctuation at a given terminal of transmission line. So therefore VAR compensation improves the stability of AC system by increasing the maximum active power that can be transmitted. Okay. So what is reactive power compensation? It is the management of reactive power to improve the performance of AC systems. So by removing all these things, that is by improving power factor and by balancing the power drawn from the system, compensating voltage regulation and removing harmonics and decreasing the voltage fluctuations, by doing all these things the stability of the system will be increased and maximum active power can be transmitted. So demand of reactive power is mainly originated from inductive load connected to the system. So these inductive loads generally are electromagnetic circuit of electric motors, electrical transformers, distribution networks and induction furnaces, etc. So reactive power compensation is defined as the management of reactive power to improve the performance of AC systems for load compensation and voltage support. Now let us see what is reactive power. Power is referred as the product of voltage and current. We all know this one, okay? So power is nothing but product of voltage and current. So the portion of electricity that establishes and sustains the electric and magnetic fields of alternating current equipment. So reactive power must be supplied to most types of magnetic equipment such as motors and transformers. In an AC transmission, when the voltage and current go up and down, at the same time, only real power is transmitted, and when there is a time shift between voltage and current, both active and reactive power will be transmitted. So what we are telling here, in AC system, AC transmission system, when voltage and current will go up and down, at the same time only real power is transmitted, and when there is a time shift between voltage and current, both active and reactive power will be transmitted. So let us see the analogy of reactive power. What is analogy? Why an analogy? Okay. So reactive power is an essential aspect of the electricity system, but one that is difficult to comprehend by a layman. Okay. We know that reactive power is nothing but what? It is not the true power or actual power. It is the power which will be taken by the load and it will be given back. Okay, taken and given back. In the one cycle, the element is taking the current. In the next cycle, it is giving back. So net power will be zero. But still, it is having its own importance. Okay, the horse and boat analogy best describes the reactive power aspect. Visualize a boat on a canal pulled by a horse on the bank of the canal. It's as shown in the figure. So in the horse and boat analogy, horse's objective, that is real power, is to move the boat straightly. The fact that the rope is being pulled from the flank of the horse and not straight behind it limits the horse's capacity to deliver real work of moving straightly. Okay. Therefore, power required to keep the boat steady in navigating straightly is delivered by the rudder movement, that is reactive power. So without reactive power, there can be no transfer of real power. Likewise, without the support of rudder, boat cannot move in a straight line. Now let us see the power triangle. Okay, so what is a power triangle? It is a triangle which in which we can see there are real power, reactive power and apparent power. So real power units are watts, reactive power units are volt ampere reactive, and apparent power units are volt ampere. Okay, this is impedance triangle or power triangle. It can be, see here, this is real power, reactive power, and addition of real and reactive power will be apparent power. Power factor is nothing but cosine of angle between voltage and current. It is nothing but cos phi. Okay, power factor can be represented as cos phi, that is real power by apparent power. So real power is represented in kilowatts and apparent power is represented in volt ampere. So kilowatt by kilovolt ampere is nothing but power factor. So whenever there is a phase shift between voltage and current, we have real power in kilowatt and reactive power, that is imaginary, in kilovolt ampere. So combination is a complex or apparent power. So addition of these two, the combination of real power and reactive power, is apparent power, KVA, that is equal to root of kilowatt square plus KVAR square. Okay, so here I am writing KVA, or it can be, unit can be KVA also. Here also VAR or KVAR, here watts or kilowatts. So now apparent power will be equal to what? Apparent power square is equal to real power square plus reactive power square. So what I am writing here in place of apparent power, I am taking this as KVA. KVA square is equal to kilowatt square plus VAR square, or KVA is equal to root of kilowatt square plus KVAR square. So there are three powers here: active, reactive and apparent power. Active power is represented by P, reactive power represented by Q, apparent power represented by S. And this is the angle phi. Phi is the phase angle, and cosine of phi will give us the power factor. Now let us see the definitions of active power, reactive power and apparent power. Active power is the power that actually powers the equipment and performs useful work. Its unit is watts or kilowatts. Reactive power, it is represented by Q. It is the power that magnetic equipment needs to produce the magnetizing flux. Unit of it is volt ampere reactive. It can be used in transformers, motors, etc. Apparent power, it is represented by S. It is a vectorial summation of active power and reactive power. Unit of it is volt ampere. Reactive power, the portion of power flow that is temporarily stored in the form of magnetic or electric fields due to inductive or capacitive network element and then returned to source is known as reactive power. So reactive power can best be described as a quantity of unused power that is stored in reactive components such as inductors or capacitors. In other words, reactive circuits returns as much power to the supply as it consumes. Okay, as I said earlier, what is the meaning of reactive power? A reactive circuit will return as much power to the supply as it consumes. Whatever it is consuming, it is giving it back. Okay. So in resistive loads, so now why do we need reactive power? In resistive loads, current produces the heat energy which will produce the desired output. But in case of inductive loads, current creates the magnetic field which will further produce the desired work. Therefore, reactive power is the non-working power caused by the magnetic current to operate and sustain magnetism in the device. So what is reactive power? It is a non-working power which is caused by the magnetic current to operate and sustain magnetism in the device. So reactive power, that is volt ampere reactives, is required to maintain the voltage to deliver active power through transmission lines. When there is not enough reactive power, voltage will sag down and it is not possible to deliver the required power to load through the lines. Reactive power generated by the AC power source is stored in a capacitor or a reactor during a quarter of a cycle, and in the next quarter of the cycle, it is sent back to the power source. Therefore, reactive power will oscillate between the AC source and the capacitor or reactor at a frequency which is equal to 2 times the rated value. So rated value can be 50 or 60 hertz. So reactive power will oscillate between the AC source and the capacitor or between the AC source and the reactor, which is at a frequency which is equal to 2 times the rated frequency. So to avoid the circulation between the load and the source, it needs to be compensated. Also, to regulate the power factor of the system and maintain the voltage stability, we need to compensate reactive power. So, methods of reactive power compensation, there are basically five methods: shunt compensation, series compensation, synchronous condensers, static VAR compensators, static compensators. Shunt compensation. The device that is connected in parallel with the transmission line is called as shunt compensator. Okay. The device which will be connected in parallel with the transmission line is called as shunt compensator. Shunt compensator is always connected in the middle of the transmission line. It can be provided by either a current source, voltage source or a capacitor. Ideal shunt compensator will provide reactive power to the system. Shunt connected reactors are used to reduce the line over voltages by consuming the reactive power, while shunt connected capacitors are used to maintain the voltage levels by compensating the reactive power to transmission lines. So, what does an ideal shunt compensator do? Ideal shunt compensator will provide the reactive power to the system, and shunt connected reactors will be used to reduce the line over voltages by consuming reactive power. Shunt connected reactors will reduce the line voltages by consuming reactive power, whereas shunt connected capacitors will maintain the voltage levels. So, this is a transmission line with shunt compensation. Okay, this is a transmission line. There are two buses, bus 1, bus 2. Currents I1 and I2 flowing through it. And this is a capacitor, shunt compensation, which is connected in parallel in the transmission line. Let us see the series compensation. When a device is connected in series with the transmission line, it is called as series compensator. A series compensator can be connected anywhere in the line. There are two modes of operation. One is capacitive mode of operation and another one is inductive mode of operation. So, simplified model of a transmission system is series compensation is shown in figure. Here, we can see here capacitor is connected in series in the line, transmission line. The voltage magnitudes of the two buses are assumed as V and the phase angle between them is delta. Okay, voltages are represented by V. Voltage across inductor is represented by VL and voltage across capacitor is represented by VC and angle is delta. Now, let us see static VAR compensator. Static VAR compensator or SVC is an electrical device for providing reactive power on transmission networks. The term static will refer to the fact that the SVC has no moving parts other than circuit breakers and disconnects which do not move under normal SVC operation. So, SVC or static VAR compensator is an automated impedance matching device which is designed to bring the system closer to unity power factor. If the power system's reactive load is capacitive, that is, if it is leading, SVC will use reactors to consume VARs from the system which will lower the system voltage. And the SVC which will use reactors are usually in the form of thyristor controlled reactors. Okay, so what we are telling here, SVC, it is an automated impedance matching device which is designed to bring the system closer to unity power factor. And if the power system's reactive load is capacitive, SVC will use reactors to consume VARs from the system to lower the system voltage. Now, let us see second case, that is under inductive conditions, capacitor banks are automatically switched in, thus providing a higher system voltage. This is a static VAR compensator, thyristor switched reactor, this one, and this is the bank of three individually switched capacitors. Okay. So, what are the advantages of using the static VAR composition? So, static VAR composition is not done at line voltage. A bank of transformers will step the transmission voltage, for example, 230 kV down to a much lower level, for example, 9.5 kV. So, this will reduce the size and number of components. Second advantage is that they are more reliable. Third one is they are faster in operation. Fourth one, smoother control and more flexibility can be provided with the help of thyristors. So, the devices use as next one is static compensator. The devices use synchronous voltage sources for generating or absorbing reactive power. So, synchronous voltage source SVS is constructed using a voltage source converter VSC. Such a shunt compensating device is called as static compensator or STATCOM. STATCOM usually contains an SVS that is driven from a DC storage capacitor and the SVS is connected to the AC system bus through an interface transformer, and transformer will step the AC system voltage down such that the voltage rating of SPS switches are within specified limit. So this is the basic structure of a STATCOM. STATCOM will comprise of power converters, set of coupling reactors or step-up transformer, and a controller. Okay. This is a PWM pulse width modulation inverter, and here we are giving the control input to the control system. Then it will be given to the inverter. And this is the feeder between B1 and B2. This is the capacitor. So it will consist of, STATCOM consist of power converters, set of coupling reactors or step-up transformer. Okay, this is a step-up transformer and a controller. So we are characteristics of SVC and STATCOM. We are comparing here. This is the capacitive and this is inductive sides. This is the voltage is reference here. So this will be the characteristics of SVC, and these are the characteristics of STATCOM. We are characteristics of STATCOM. Let us see the advantages of STATCOM. So reactive components used in the STATCOM are much smaller than those in the SVC. And characteristics of STATCOM are superior than SVC. And output current of STATCOM can be controlled up to the rated maximum capacitive or inductive range. Fourth one will be reduction of the capacity of a semiconductor power converter and capacitor bank to one half of those for the conventional SVC. And better transient response of the order of quarter cycle, and there will be reduction in harmonic filter capacity by using STATCOM. And there will be reduction of size of high value air cooled reactor and reduction of equipment volume and footprint. Let us see synchronous condenser. What is a synchronous condenser? It is a device whose main function is the improvement of power factor of electrical system. Okay, it is installed at the receiving end of the line. So what is a synchronous condenser? It is the device whose function is the improvement of power factor of electrical system. So when a synchronous condenser is introduced, it supplies KVAR to the system, and hence the current will be reduced. Therefore, the losses are reduced and it will provide a better efficiency. Okay, whenever a current is getting reduced, losses are getting reduced. So losses are reduced, hence efficiency will be better. So more power can be delivered to the load and improves the power factor of the system. So what we have understood from all this discussion, that reactive power compensation is must for improving the performance of the AC system. Okay, why we need to learn reactive power? Because we have to learn about reactive power because it will improve the performance of the AC system. By reactive power compensation, we can control the power factor and reduce the consumption of electricity. Thank you everyone for watching the video. In the next class, I will be telling in detail about all these devices, okay, separately. So today's class, it was just an introduction class. So we have seen what is the importance of reactive power, why we need to study the reactive power, okay. So what we have studied in today's class. So this is your syllabus, reactive power generation by synchronous generators and automatic voltage regulators and TCAC, STATCOM, UPFC. Okay, only few topics are there in 5th unit. You may expect a one big question, one long question and one short or two short questions from this unit, okay. So it's a very small unit and very easy unit and very interesting too. So students, everyone please concentrate on these lectures and prepare your own notes from these lectures. Okay. So in today's class, we have studied about what is reactive power, what is the need for reactive power, and what is the need for reactive power compensation, shunt, series, the static VAR, STATCOM, and synchronous condensers. We have seen the introductions. Okay. So, reactive power compensation is nothing but management of reactive power to improve the performance of AC systems. So, two aspects are there in this, load compensation and voltage support. Okay. So, power is equal to voltage into current and portion of electricity that establishes and sustains the electric and magnetic fields of alternating current equipment. Reactive power must be supplied to most types of magnetic equipment such as motors and transformers. In AC transmission, when voltage and current will go up and down at the same time, only real power will be transmitted, and there is a time shift between the voltage and current, both real and reactive powers will be transmitted. Then we have seen one analogy of reactive power. We have seen an example. Okay. Then we have seen a power triangle. So there are three main parts in a power triangle. One is the active power or real power, reactive power, and apparent power. Okay. and apparent power will be vector addition of real power and reactive power, and cos phi is representing here power factor, that is cosine of angle between voltage and current in an AC circuit is called as power factor. It is given by real power by apparent power or R by Z. Resistance by impedance is also cos phi. Kilowatt by KVA is nothing but cos phi. Okay. So what is active power? It is a power that will actually power the equipment and performs useful work. What is reactive power? It is a power that magnetic equipment need to produce the magnetizing flux. What is apparent power? It is a vectorial summation of active power and reactive power. Units we know. Okay. Units of active power is watts or kilowatts. Reactive power units is volt ampere, reactive VAR or KVAR. Apparent power units are volt ampere or kilovolt ampere. Then we have seen about reactive power. So, what is reactive power? Portion of power flow that is temporarily stored in the form of magnetic or electric fields due to inductive or capacitive network elements and then returned to source is called as reactive power. So, it is an unused power. What exactly is reactive power? It is unused power that is stored in reactive components like inductors and capacitors. And reactive circuit will return as much power to the supply as it consumes. So, this we have to understand. Okay, we have to understand what exactly is reactive power. It is the unused power that is stored in reactive components like inductors and capacitors. Okay, and reactive circuit will return as much power to the supply as it consumes. Okay, our students, please make a note of this point. Then we have seen reactive power is required to maintain the voltage to deliver active power through transmission lines. Then we have seen what are the various methods of reactive power compensation: shunt series, synchronous condenser, static VAR compensators, static compensators. Okay, we have seen just what exactly is series shunt, okay, and static VAR, what are these advantages, okay, STATCOM and all. So thank you everyone for watching the video. Thank you.